Hi everyone. Today let us talk about Mastoid air cell system. It was asked in October 88. Okay, this is important. Clinically also this is important. At the same time, this was asked previously also. So if from the exam point of view also this is important. But it's a short topic. So what is Mastoid? Mastoid consists of bone cortex with a honeycomb of air cells beneath. Okay, this is what we are talking about. There are the small septa that you can see. Okay, these are the small septa that are present in between the air cells. So these are the honeycomb kind of pattern. You remember this honeycomb, right? Honeycomb kind of pattern you will see. This is exactly how the cells appear. Okay, there are thin septa in between these cells. So depending on the kind of pneumatization, there are three types of mastoid have been described. One is a well pneumatized or a cellular mastoid. Well pneumatized or a cellular mastoid. Here the cells are well developed. As you can see here, the cells are going beyond the sinus plate. Suppose if this is the sinus plate, they are going beyond the sinus plate. Mastoid cortex, if you just remove the outer plate of bone, maybe even 2 or 3 millimeters, you will start seeing these cells. So this is actually a dream of every otologist, maybe ENT surgeons like me, because it is so easy to operate on this case, in the sense that most of the structures you can see, the chance of causing damage to the important structures is very less. Reaching your goal of clearing the disease becomes easy. But to be frank, if the patient is having such a well pneumatized and cellular mastoid, the chance of disease developing in such mastoids is also very less. So much of cellular you will see in temporal bone dissections. When you start doing temporal bone dissections, you will see that the moment you open the outer plate of bone, looking from the lateral side, if this is the plate of bone, just beneath it you will start seeing cells. So the moment you start opening, suppose this is the mastoid antrum. Mastoid antrum is 1.5 centimeters away from the lateral surface of the mastoid. So just by removing, you will start seeing these cells. I could see this when I was doing temporal bone dissection. Most of the cases, it will be like this. So it is such a fun coming to this. So well pneumatized or cellular mastoid, if the cells are well developed and intervening cell septa are thin. So you'll start opening these cells immediately. So this is called a well pneumatized or a cellular mastoid. Diploidic mastoid. Diploidic mastoid means it contains a few marrow spaces, and a few air cells. So this is the temporomandibular joint. This is the temporomandibular joint. As you can see, this is the line of the temporomandibular joint. This is the external auditory canal opening. This is the dural plate. This is the line, dural line or the temporal line. This is a sinodural angle. This is the temporal line. And here you have somewhere here you will have the sinus plate. So here you can see this black kind of a shadow here. This black kind of a shadow is nothing but the air cells. Air always appears black in any X-ray or any CT scan. All the tissues, the more whiter it is, it means it's a bone. The more grayish it is kind of soft tissue. Okay. Here this is in between the well pneumatized and the sclerotic mastoid. Sclerotic mastoid also called acellular mastoid. So here this is well developed, having multiple air cells with very thin septa, and there is so much of pneumatization that has happened in this temporal bone. Around the external auditory canal, you can see thick bone. As you go posteriorly, you can see a few air cells here. So this is called a diploidic mastoid. Okay. And now you have the sclerotic or acellular mastoid. Here this is the temporomandibular, this is the glenoid fossa, this is the temporomandibular joint, this is the what is called the head of the mandible. Then this is the external auditory canal. Here the delineation is so clear. Here above you have the brain. Here this is the posterior cranial fossa behind. So see, there are no cells on it. Entire thing is like bleached out kind of a thing, totally white. This is a sinodural angle. So there are no air cells only. When you want to know what kind of the mastoid that I'm going to deal with in this case, you can take an X-ray of that X-ray mastoids of that patient, and lateral view with a little bit of angle, they remove this and they will give you this picture. Then you can say, okay, this is how much far away I'm away from the temporal line or from the dural plate, and how much far away I am from this sinus plate. So you can make some decision. Okay, So what are three types of mastoid? One is a well-nematized or a cellular mastoid. The other one is a acellular mastoid where there are no cells at all. This is lots of cells. There are no cells. And in between these two, you have what is called a diploidic mastoid. Diploidic mastoid. Okay, coming to clinical significance of applied anatomy, whatever, even in a totally acellular mastoid, antrum is always present, but it may be smaller in size. So around the superior part of this, you may have a small mastoid here. If you are lucky, that if there is no low-lying dura or forward-lying sinus, then there is enough space for you to drill. Otherwise, you have to start drilling with a very small burr, which becomes a danger in itself. Always drilling with a bigger size burr is a good thing because you will not damage structures because it will remove bone from a larger surface. So antrum is always present, but it may be smaller in size. There may be low-lying dura and forward-lying sinus, especially in ACLR kind of mastoid. You should be more careful. So doing an X-ray mastoids will give you an idea what it is, what kind of mastoid I'm going to deal with this when you are drilling in this such cases. Now coming to the types of mastoid air cells, depending on the location, there are all these mastoid air cells, depending on the location, they are given one name. As we are going from in an anti-clockwise direction, what are the mastoid cells that we are going to encounter? Let us see. In the root of the zygoma, this is what I was telling, you know, glenoid fossa. Here you will have the head of the mandible. You will have the zygomatic air cells. First, you will have the zygomatic air cells in the root of the zygoma. Zygomatic air cells in the root of zygoma. As you go anticlockwise, the first thing that you may see, you will see the tegmen air cells. Around the tegmen plate, around the dural plate, around that supramastoid crest that we call it, temporal line. The air cell that you will see here, let me put a different color. The air cells that you see here are called tegmen cells. And then the cells which are present in the squama of the temporal bone, the squama of the temporal that's going up, forming the lateral boundary of the middle cranial fossa. The cells there that you are going to see are called the squamosal cells. So first you saw the zygomatic cells. As you are going in an anticlockwise direction, you saw the tegmen cells, and then you have the squamosal cells. As you are going more posterior, more anticlockwise, you may see sinodural angle cells, where there is a junction between the sinus plate and the dural plate, sinodural angle cells. As you are going more anticlockwise, you will see the cells around the sinus or the lateral sinus. They are called the perisinus cells. As you are going more in an anticlockwise direction, the tip of the mastoid, you will see tip cells. Okay. Now coming to, once you have done the cortical mastoid, what are the structures you are going to see? You are going to see the facial nerve. You are going to see this lateral semicircular canal, which is a part of the labyrinth. Then there is antrum is there. Okay. So around this fascia, you call it retrofacial cells. Around the sinus is called perisinus cells. Around the antrum, you call it periantral cells. Around the labyrinth, you call it perilabyrinthine cells. All these cells are present in the mastoid, in the cortical, after doing a cortical mastoidectomy. Peritubal cells are still present in the anterior part of this, anterior part of the middle ear, where the eustachian tube opens. There you will have the cells around it. It's called the peritubal cells. Okay, so these are the kind of cells that we encounter. So coming to one, just a quick revision of this, try to remember it in one way so that it is easier for you to remember. Going from an anti-clockwise direction, first you are going to see the zygomatic cells. Second, then you are going to see the tegmen cells. Then you are going to see the squamosal cells. Then you will have the sinodural angle cells, then perisinus cells, tip cells. In the cortical mastoidectomy, you see retrofacial cells, and then you go into the ear, let us finish this. Periantral cells, and then perilabyrinthine cells around the labyrinth, and peritubal cells. So there are 9 kind of cells. I hope you can remember it. If you have some system by which you can remember it, then it will be easier for you. Now there is one clinical significance to these perilabyrinthine cells. Now you have a petrous bone, right? The temporal bone has 3 parts, right? The squamous part of the temporal bone, the petrous part of the temporal bone, and the meatal, and I'm not getting the right word. So this is a petrous apex. Okay, this is the now in the temporal bone. After reaching the antrum, you will see this lateral semicircular canal, and there you have the labyrinth. Around the labyrinth also there will be some cells. Sometimes the pneumatization will extend up to the petrous apex. Then the infection from here can extend into the petrous apex to form petrositis. So we are going to talk about this in CSOM mitochondrial disease complications, but I'm just telling you. So there, all the cells are basically communicating with each other. So each cell is not a separate entity. There is a communication between all the cells. Every cell is communicating with other cells. No, not one of the cells is a separate entity. So if there is infection in the perilabyrinthine cell, sometimes it may extend into the petrous apex cells also. Okay, so these are the location, these are the mastoid air cell system. In this, what did we talk about? We said, okay, there are well-pneumatized cells, diploidic mastoid, sclerotic air cells, antrum is always present. And we talked about zygomatic cells, tegmen cells, squamosal cells, perisinus cells, tip cells, retrofacial cells, periantral cells, perilabyrinthine cells, and peritubular cells. Okay, thank you for the patient listening. This was a short topic, but a clinically important one. Thank you.